C-sharp is changing towards functional programming languages in the recent years. That is one of the directions in which C-sharp is evolving. And many C-sharp programmers, many experienced C-sharp programmers have a hard time to adapt to that change. I cannot tell it all in one video, so in this video I will only focus on designing types. Let's begin. Open your mind. Try not to see what I do through classes. This will be functional programming through the entire demo. I will be designing my good old bookstore application again. All my videos are doing the same things over again. I want to model a book with a title. Instead of a class, I would just use a record. And that is all. One line of code, and I have maybe a 50, maybe 100 lines of code hiding behind, but I had to write only one line of code, and that's all. Where is the validation? There will be some validation, don't worry, but it's not here. This is the type. I want to specify the authors in the book. I will use another record. I will call it name. It will be the name of the author. Currently, it is empty. Like an empty class. It has no properties. It has nothing in it. But that would let me define an array of names of authors for any book. The functions are defined separately, and every type naturally has a couple of functions that always come with it, such as factory functions. There is the primary constructor on the book type, but I will never call it. So let's start with a very simple factory function. It is typical to call them create. This is the equivalent to a constructor on a traditional class. This factory function, this static factory function, is the place for validation. But before we get to implementing the factory function, there is a problem here. You see that I have used the same name for the static class and for the type. That cannot be. So either I rename this static class or I change the name of the book type. That is the first moment where we face that dilemma. How do we view this code? If I watched it from my object-oriented eyes, I would keep the name book on the record and name the static class something else, because I wouldn't want to see that static class, but I would want to see the book record all around. Well, in functional programming, it all goes the other way around. I will say book.create, and that really makes sense to me, book.create. And the book record, my intention is to actually never see it. Therefore, in functional modeling, it is common to rename the record into something like book data, book state, or book type. Since we are modeling types, there is this naming convention to just append type to every record. Now we get to validation. Validation is what we put in the factory function. I'm saying function all the time because in functional programming it is functions. Let's get back to validation. Validation done this way is again so object-oriented. In functional programming, we don't like exceptions. We need something better. We need a better return type that would say that the book type may or may have not been instantiated, depending on validity of the input arguments. Unfortunately, C-sharp does not support optional objects. F-sharp, for example, always supported them. Unfortunately, C-sharp is not there yet. I will use vanilla C-sharp at this stage. So that would be a nullable book type. C-sharp creators right now believe that nullable types are just good for programmers. And that would be the inception of the smart constructor. in which we naturally validate the input parameters. If they are invalid, for example, the title is null or white space, then we just don't create the book type. I will return null here. Otherwise, we do create the object. I will repeat that same exercise on the name record, and I will make it more interesting, as you will see. But before that, I have some coupons to share with you for the Dome Train video courses. Dome Train is an online courses platform run by fellow content creator Nick Chapsis, and it is the go-to place for up-to-date courses on modern software engineering topics. From testing to clean architecture and modular monoliths, all the way to DDD, microservices, Docker, and Kubernetes, Dome Train has a rich collection of courses that will help you get up to speed with each topic by expert authors who have been practicing what they teach in real companies for years. Dome Train just launched Dome Train Pro, a subscription offering that gives access to all of the platform's courses. With more than 24,000 satisfied students, you can't go wrong with the Dome Train. And the first 100 of you can use code Zoran to get 15% off any course. Now let's get back to my demo. I want to make designing this name type more interesting because I see two variants of names. The full name with the two components, the first name and last name, and the other one with only one component, the mononym. Both are the name. Now back to object-oriented design, you might see this as a hierarchy of classes, and that would be fine. Between the lines, it will be hierarchy of types here too, but that is only the implementation detail of the language. Another note, functional programming also supports polymorphic execution, but not in exactly the same way as object-oriented programming does. Let's implement these. I will add that type word to each of these, but then comes the substance. I will make the name type abstract, and the two variants will derive from it. So they will be kinds of name, and I will make them internal. I don't want anyone outside to see that these variants exist, these record types exist. This is not a universal solution, but it will be helpful, you will see. The factory functions come again, the smart constructor, but this time it will be polymorphic. I can create a name type, nullable, optional one, starting from two components, the first name and last name. But what if I had only one component? There will be another smart constructor for that case. And then, how do we use these types? If you are a patron, you can download the entire source code with a few additions to what I will show you here. So you don't have to type all this. Visit my Patreon page and download the source code from there. There's the link in the description. Here I will try to instantiate a few authors. I'm using both variants of the factory function, and since each of them is returning the name type, there is no issue assigning an array of those to a variable. But still, you might be curious, what type is this? Let me show you. It is the array of nullable name type. That's not what I want. Look what I want. Speaking of smart constructors, I want a nullable array of name types that are not nullable. I mean, I want either to have all the authors or not to have them. I don't want to have an array with some authors missing because they didn't pass validation. If any of them failed validation, I don't want to get any authors back. How do I implement that? Once we get to optional objects, it will all fit into place. That sounds like another factory function and another smart constructor to me. I will call it create many, and it will have the return type, which is exactly what I said, an array of name types, which is nullable. I will check if any of the names in the array is null, then the entire result is null, which means there is no array of outers from what I am concerned. Otherwise, I am casting the array of nullable name types into a nullable array of non-nullable name types. Now figure that out. This is one of the reasons why we have the bang operator in C#. The compiler cannot check all the conditions. And when it fails, you can tell it that you have checked it and nothing is null. Fine, now I have my optional array of names. How can I fix this? It is easy. And it's even short. Use the create many smart constructor, pass it the optional names created by one or the other factory function, the smart constructor for names. And voila, I have it. I have the outers. Or not. They are optional. I will return to my beloved var keyword. I will add some procedural code to make a book out of these outers. If outers are not there, then there won't be a book either. I could end this demonstration here. This is what it means to design types in functional style. Let me just try to use these types very briefly so that you can see what we have got with that. What if I wanted to turn a name into a printable label? Look, the variants are internal. I cannot access them. That is where another functional concept comes to play. Pattern matching. Functional code is all about matching patterns. Watch this. I want to match, let me write it. I want to match the name into a result R. I will make it an extension method that is common in functional C#. Do you know when extension methods were added to C#? They came together with the link. And do you know what link is? Link is the first class functional library. And so, this extension method will apply a mapping to the name and convert a name into an unknown type R. But there are two mappings that we must support. One is from two components, and the other is from one component. Implementing this match extension on the name will require a switch expression, which is another novelty in C#, and another functional piece of syntax. You will rarely use switch expressions in anything that is not functional. Also, type test and set patterns. Functional, totally functional. You would never check or almost never check for the type in object-oriented code. Downcasting in object-oriented code is reserved for performance optimizations alone. I cannot remember any other use of it. In regular object-oriented code, downcasting is a code smell. But in functional programming, you don't have the derivation in the object-oriented sense. You have types. And so you check for types and isolate a variable of that type if you need to work to operate on that type. You implement polymorphic methods, polymorphic functions, by covering all the variants that can happen, which is full name or mononym in this case. And then, thanks to the fact that you're writing code in C#, you must also add the catch-all branch and fail in that case. The reason why we must end the switch expression this way is that C# cannot guess that there will never be another derived type derived from the name type above. That is an unfortunate situation. For example, in F#, we don't have that problem at all. Anyway, this mapping is over. I can go back to this printable method and implement it. Look how I will implement it. I will match the name. If it has two components, I will format it this way. If it has one component, I will format it that way. I want to print this title, but how do I do that when the book is nullable? Well, I'm using the null propagation operator here. If I just said book.title, the compiler would raise the warning and tell me that I am potentially dereferencing a null. I have added a few functional extensions. One of them is to apply another function to an optional object. I'm effectively using the nullable string in a monadic way. So I said it, the monad. Oh, will the world collapse now? I don't think so. Monads are causing irrational fear among C-sharp programmers. But I'll tell you a secret, you are using monads almost every day. Type in the comment which of the everyday types you use in C-sharp is the monad. How about an optional collection of outers then? I can keep using the nullable types as a monad in their monadic way. So I will optionally substitute a missing collection of outers with an empty array. Then, turn every element in that collection to its printable form by applying the printable function below to every element. And eventually, passing each element, no matter how many of them there are, to a separate call to write line. Let me get above, I don't like this procedural testing of null. No, I can optionally map the array of outers into a book, another functional call. What do you say about this code? It is entirely different from a traditional C-sharp application. This is functional code in plain C-sharp. I added nothing, no libraries, nothing. And I have the polymorphism as well. All right, from this point on, you should be able to start learning how to design behavior on functional types. That will be the topic of some future video. Now, where you can get the source code? Source code is available to patrons of my channel, so please become the patron. I'm really grateful to everyone who is helping me maintain this channel. That will give you access to all the source code I ever made. And in this case, the source code bundle also includes a lot of behavior defined on these types. And it also includes an implementation of a minimal API, which is, guess what? A functional library.